mimics exactly what Nick requires to, for us to be able to recycle carpet. These are the things that we can't have in it. And, you know, we spend money. Anytime a load gets to our facility, it costs us labor time, and it devalues the whole product because we spend all this time and labor and equipment to remove these things. And then also the disposal costs and all of the materials to make sure they're away. Next slide. I'll go through this quickly. I just thought this was important. A lot of people don't even understand why, how carpet is made, so I thought it was just...
Sorry, it's too early for my form, girl.
Okay, so the part that you walk on was plastic. I mean, when I first got into this, I had no idea what was getting recycled out of carpet. And then there's this, and usually that is polypropylene, nylon 6/6, wool, PET, I have a list on the next page. And then normally, almost always, that primary backing and that secondary backing is polypropylene. So it's a different polymer in a lot of cases than what's in the face fiber. And that makes it difficult to recycle because you have two different polymers together. So you have to have a lot of capital and a lot of resources to separate those two polymers. And then there's a filler. And the filler is calcium carbonate and latex that holds the whole carpet together. That gives the carpet the weight so it lays on the floor nicely. But it's a nightmare when you're trying to recycle it. Next slide. So here's a picture. I actually pulled apart a piece of carpet. The secondary backing, and then you can see that white crusty stuff. That's calcium carbonate and latex SBR. And then that, you know, the face fiber loops through those, and that's a portion of carpet. What a lot of people also don't know is when I get that carpet, only 50% of it will be recycled. And that is the polymers. 50% by weight generally is the calcium carbonate SBR. There are not any living homes for that material. So after I remove the plastic, I have a cost to throw away 50% of that material. Now, you know, Nick makes, he shears off the top of that carpet, so he has a really nice polymer, but then he has a carcass. And that's probably 75% of the weight of the carpet. He has set up for somebody that can take that. That's great. But a lot of people that are out this year do not have that. That gets thrown away. So really only 25% of that carpet is being recycled. I think that's very important to bring up.
Wait, can you repeat that last part? What did you just say about the weight and do what?
Okay, so not in his case, I think he has an outlet that will take his carcasses. That he's taken the carpet and he's shaved off the top.
Okay.
And then there's the calcium, the two primary backings.
The SBR
and the SBR. Generally, no shearing carpet, they throw that away. So only 25% is recycled. Now, there are a couple companies that are cropping up that are going to take carcasses, but their throughput's very low. They will never be able to keep up with the amount of shearers that are out there right now. And if you're processing carcasses, think about it, you're only getting 25% possibly of that fiber out of it. So there's not a lot of incentive to process carcasses. Our process, we remove about 40% of that backing. We still have somewhere between 5 and 10% of backing. So our recyclable material is about 40 to 50%, depending on the structure of the carpet, of 40-50% is actually recycled. The calcium carbonate, we recycle, we send to a place, energy facilities, and they use it. But when there's issues with that too. 5 minutes, okay? The highest value is something like Nick's do. He's going to get the most value out of the polymer because he's shaving it. There's not a lot of contaminants. What we do, you know, what we sell is at a lower price point because we have a lot of contaminants still in it. We have a polypropylene mixed with a nylon. And really, the calcium carbonate that's being pulled out of the carpet, there are not a lot of good solutions. PET is important, but really, calcium carbonate is incredibly important for us to be finding a solution because 50% of our raw material just gets thrown away. I could pay somebody to take material and then throw it away and pay for it again. Does that make sense? So it's important for me as a processor to find a solution for calcium carbonate. That to me is just as important, if not more, than PET. Next slide. Okay, I already talked about this. Not all carpet. The wovens are very difficult to recycle. And the structure of those, people like me can't process it, only people like me, there's only two of us out there that can really take this type of material. So, you know, when we're collecting this stuff, if it's commercial carpet, there's only a handful of people, we're not very close to Chicago or Illinois, so.
I mean, it really is, you find out, you know each other well, because you're trading, you're telling each other, you know, because there's things out there. So, yeah, there's none of the stand alone.
Right, no, no, we support each other.
Yeah.
Next slide. Okay, and this is just, this is actually from the Carpet Rug Institute, this is reality. PET carpet is being generated at a higher percent, and it is knocking out polypropylene, which is our best product that we make and sell at our facility. This hurts us. And then nylon 66, that's also going away and replaced PET, which is its largest product that's being sold. So this impacts our business greatly. It's important to us that PET is not going to be replacing this. And I don't know what we can do about that, but it is, it's a constant battle. Next slide. I hope everybody understands not all carpet is created equal, and it costs different amounts of money to process different types of carpets, and some people can take it, some people can't. And not all of the carpet is recycled. I think people don't understand that. I think people need to understand that we need to find a solution for the calcium carbonates and the carpets. You know, I think the other big message is, you know, we can't expect this is going to be a free thing for residents or installers or anybody. We're going to have to pay to get rid of this carpet because, as you can see, it's very costly to recycle carpet. So I think, you know, if we're starting from square one, we need to not try to tell the consumer that it's going to be or it's going to be free to get rid of the carpet. It should be at the same price as disposal. You should be able to charge the same cost as disposal. The value is, it's going to be recycled, it's not going to be thrown away in landfill. The landfill gets paid twice, or gets paid twice for the space in the landfill. They're not going to put it in the landfill, so they still have that airspace that they have to charge for it. That's a good thing to them. So,
one more?
Oh,
skeptical. Sounds like you guys are desperate for carpet.
Desperate for carpet and desperate.
And you're doing a trial with Karen about the people buying a separate colored sticker for curbside. I mean, is it cost effective for you to provide a stickers for residential pickup? I mean, I don't know what the cost is. $2, $3, I don't know. I live in Iowa, it's $1.65 to buy a sticker for your trash. Is that, I mean, is that something that would be cost effective for you, companies like yours to do?
It's the same price for the resident, but I'm sure that Heritage is making an investment up front to see if it will be.
That's what I'm saying. So, I mean, are you, is it okay for you to invest in providing the stickers so that consumers doesn't have to buy any?
No, they won't. No.
It's not?
No.
Okay.
There's a huge cost associated with picking it up. You know,
sure. Yep, I understand. I mean, if you're that desperate for it.
Yeah, and for the event like that we did for Jennifer over in King County, we had 10 of those events this year. That $175, that's break even. I'm actually losing a few dollars with the cost of doing that. It's to get that material.
And that's what I'm saying.
Yeah, it's a difficult challenge. It's a huge challenge.
And then I know Heritage in Cedar Rapids, you're working directly with Lynn County Landfill.
Yes.
So is that a better way to go after, to go to the landfill and say, hey, can we get that carpet from you?
Yeah, so it, what they'll do, it's only getting a very small percent, you're right. It's the installers that are coming to the landfill, the installers that are coming to C&D. That's good for us if it's not getting wet.
But they're sorting for you, right?
But I don't know if you said it, but the installers give the consumer an option. I'll cut it up and I'll put it, and I'll charge it, but I'll put it to curbside, or I'll take it with me. And sometimes you don't have the mechanism to take it with me.
Sure.
Because once you roll that carpet up, it's different than those nice little rolls that they bring in with the brick. Or they may be bringing in hardwood.
Yeah.
We also track the flooring industry in general. It's cyclical. Carpet goes in style, then it goes out of style. I mean, we're going through a period where the hardwoods, tiles, so they're pulling up carpet and not putting down carpet. So some of them don't have a mechanism to pull that carpet away.
All right, excellent job.